I would like to invite our the chairperson of the session, Dr. C. Govindaraj, who is an associate professor and head in charge in Department of English, Periyar University PG Extension Center, Dharmapuri, Tamil Nadu, India. He has published 35 research papers in journals, has organized national international seminars, conference, workshop, FDP, and many more. He is also a life member in ELTAI Chennai, Rock Pebbles Nagpur, member in AMLE Association for Middle Level Education, triennial member in CLAI, Comparative Literature Association of India, academic outreach as the chief editor of the Chandelier Student Magazine, member in editorial board in International Journal of Multidisciplinary Research Review, member in editorial board in International Journal of Science, Technology and Humanities, member in editorial board in English Language, Literature and Culture. Sir, we welcome you and I would like to hand over the session to you. Over to you, sir. Dr. C. Govindaraj, are you there?
Am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible. So you can take over the session, sir.
Yes, am I audible?
Yes, sir, you are audible.
Hello, Mashkantin. Am I audible?
Yeah. Your voice is audible, sir.
Yes, and yes, sir. Good evening to all of you. I'm very happy and feeling... Yeah, please. Good evening to all of you. I'm very happy and honored to be a part of this 3 days international conference on multidisciplinary. Hello?
Yes, sir.
Yes,
yes, yes.
Yeah, okay. Okay. So,
sir,
very happy and honored to be a part of this 3 days international conference on multidisciplinary socio-economic and cultural studies, and I'm feeling much happy for sharing. Having the session. And now,
sir, we have a disrupted
since we are all running short of time. I would like to invite Geetika Mishra to present her paper. Hello.
Yeah, it's a joint presentation, sir. It's Geetika Mishra and Dr.
Department of Psychology, Manipal University, to present her paper on Indian spiritual thought as the ultimate toolkit for mental weakness in COVID times. Hello.
Hello. Yes, sir. I am present.
Hello.
Am I audible?
Mashwan, am I audible?
Yes. Hello. Yes, sir. Both of you are audible. Yes. And ma'am, Geetika, actually, it's a joint presentation, right? You and Dr. Meenakshi Joshi. Is it?
Hello? Yes. Okay. Yes, sir.
Then,
hello?
Yeah, it seems like Dr. C. Govindaraj, network is not
hello?
Working properly. So you can start with the presentation, ma'am. As,
hello?
Time very less on your profile.
Okay. Shall I start my presentation?
Yes. Hello, sure, Marshan. Sir. Hello, Marshan. Yes, am I audible?
Yes, sir. You're audible. Ma'am, she can start with the presentation now.
Hello?
It's okay, ma'am. You can start with the presentation. I'll fetch him.
Okay. Good evening to everyone present here. My name is Geetika Mishra. And first of all, I would like to thank the organizers for accepting my paper and giving me the opportunity to present my paper. The title of my paper is Indian Spiritual Thought as the Ultimate Toolkit for Mental Weakness in COVID Times.
Marshall?
It is needless to say
Yeah, please. You are audible. Please carry on.
Yeah. It is needless to say that mental health during COVID-19 is going a steep downhill. Despite having the luxury of time, humans are facing difficulty in coping with the unprecedented stagnation in life that COVID-19 has offered. When we were attacked with this pandemic a year ago, the government insisted that social distancing is the only solution to save one's physical health. But we humans seem to ignore the psychological damage and took protection of mental health for granted. Every day, we are encountered with people going through depression, developing eating disorders, anxiety, mood swings, alienation, etc. COVID-19 has taken a bigger toll on people's mental health than envisaged. It's a parallel killer that nobody talks about. If we look at it psychologically, Indian scriptures do come to our rescue during such tiring times. The wisdom in ancient Indian thought still holds valid in 21st century. From the pool of Indian literature, Bhagavad Gita is one such eternal text that comes to our rescue. It is a repository of practical self-help on social, economic, and cultural issues, especially when in crisis. It is a set of principles that must be incorporated in every school as it is considered to possess the nectar of life. It is a time-tested solution for holistic well-being, meaningful relations, accomplished goals, being fully engaged in life, etc. So the paper that I'm going to present provides solutions to mental fatigue through Indian scriptures during COVID times. It aims to present Bhagavad Gita as the rule book for those who wish to retain their sanity in the face of unpredictability. Now, I would like to focus on the problems that we human beings faced during pandemic, and simultaneously, I would be giving you the solutions that are present in Bhagavad Gita. So the very first problem that we all faced is the fear of death. I believe if COVID had to be given another name, it would be death. We all must have heard this bad news someday or the other, and thus we always had this constant fear of death. That's when Bhagavad Gita comes to our rescue. This ancient time-tested wisdom starts with the feeling of death, where Arjuna, on entering the battlefield, agrees to be a beggar, but couldn't think of the death of his loved one. Gita actually is the manual for learning to face the challenges we encounter in daily life. Arjuna's dilemma, which we find in the beginning of the Gita, reflects our misgivings and lack of self-esteem. Even Swami Vivekananda says in the same vein, stand up and fight, not one step back. That is the idea. Let the star moves from the sphere. Let the whole world stand against us. You gain nothing by becoming a coward because you are an infinite, deathless, worthless soul. So arise, awake, stand up, and fight. The next problem that we all had was conflict. So in psychology, we talk about two types of conflict. The first is interpersonal conflict. I cannot speak enough of it because the news during pandemic had given us enough glimpse of increasing domestic violence during pandemic. That is what is interpersonal conflict. And when I talk about intrapersonal conflict, it is the conflict within one own self. Now let us see what Bhagavad Gita has to say about different types of conflicts. Bhagavad Gita is actually a conflict between values, beliefs, interests, and personalities as a whole. The conflict existed due to the incompatible model differences, distributional issues which hold high stake, and the conflict of power. Bhagavad Gita talks about four types of conflicts basically, but in this paper I have talked only about two types of conflict. So interpersonal conflict is when Arjuna, the commander of Pandav army, suddenly falls weak when he sees his own people standing against him. He is in dilemma whether to wage a war against them or not. Krishna makes Arjuna realize that he is a Kshatriya whose responsibility is to fight a war against Dharma. The second conflict which Bhagavad Gita talks about is intrapersonal. As one proceeds reading the Bhagavad Gita, within Arjuna, an interpersonal conflict can be seen, where he is fighting demons inside him. Arjuna's voice inside the head dominates his behavior. He seems to be caught up between two voices. One says to fight a war, and another says to not fight a war. The third problem that we all faced was the principle of work ethics. During COVID times, people were forced to work from home. There were a lot of pressure on employees as they were, bearing the burden of burnouts for which they had no breaks. Due to COVID situation being so critical, the companies were actually laying off their employees. They had to prove their worth all over again. In the process, the employees were having a tough time, and Bhagavad Gita also talks about this situation. In the first stage, when Arjun enters the battlefield, an ethical dilemma dawns upon him. He frets that in order to wage war, he has to kill his brothers who stood against him. Shri Krishna exhorts Arjuna to take up arms and wage a war. He tries to provide logical arguments in front of Arjuna and says that setting into a battlefield would be the most honorable way. Many scholars actually comprehend Gita as promoting homicide, but their perception is totally flawed. They overlooked that it is not the war which Sri Krishna emphasizes, rather one's duty. Taking the example of Arjuna's dilemma forward, Sri Krishna explains that Arjuna took training in archery from one of the most eminent teachers in the society at that time. His teacher not only taught him skills, but also sacrificed the interest of other student archers like Eklavya. Sri Krishna posits that indirectly, the whole society has contributed to Arjuna's extraordinary archery skills. And now, when he has to put the lessons into practice, he cannot move back from his prime responsibility, which is to fight on behalf of the society. And that is what is known as Karma Yoga in Bhagavad Gita. I would not take a lot of time, as I know we are short of time. So I would like to conclude my paper by saying that Bhagavad Gita is the repository of values. In sense, what it tells is that we should have faith in ourselves towards the instruction given by others. We should not neglect our duties. We should always perform our duties with all our dedication and without craving for results. Thank you and have a nice day.
Thank you so much, ma'am. It seems like Dr. Govindaraj has just joined. So, sir, are you there?
Yes, I'm audible.
I'm not able to continue. So, shall I call the second presenter?
Yes, please. You may proceed with the, please. Call upon the next one.
Ma'am Nijika, thank you so much. So, I'll call the next presenter now.
Welcome.
The next presenter is by Kaisam Nomita, research scholar, and Professor M.C. Arun Kumar. Professor Department of Anthropology, Manipur University, Manipur, on the topic Impression of Body Image Through Internet Usage, a case study of Manipur women. So, sir, are you there?
Thank you.
Yeah, yeah. Kaisam Numita and Professor MC Arun Kumar. Are you there? It seems like they are not present, sir. So,
yes, I think they are not present here. Better you can call upon the next presenter.
Yeah,
please. Okay.
So, I would like to call Mr. Ms. Moirangtham Nandibala Chanu, Research Scholar, Department of Political Science, Manipur University, on her topic, Women Empowerment, Breaking the Glass Ceiling. Ma'am, are you there?
Yes, I'm here.
Okay, welcome, ma'am. And
myself, Moirangtham Nandibala Chanu, Research Scholar, Department of Political Science, Manipur University. The title of my paper is Women Empowerment, Breaking the Glass Ceiling. So I will come to my introductory part. Most of the countries adopted democratic form of government which provides gender equality in the 21st century. It is a society in which men and women enjoy the same opportunities, outcomes, rights, and obligations in all spheres of life. So gender equality is a basic human right. Yet, at present, many women around the world still lack basic human rights and face discrimination and gender-based violence in their everyday life. No country today can claim to have achieved gender equality. Persistent inequality throughout the life cycle often robs women the chance to make empowered decisions about their existence, future, and in turn, those of their own children. Women constitute half of the human population on Earth. And where women constitute half of the population, their representation in the political system should be equal to that of men. However, when we look at the world's parliaments, women is underrepresented. With a global average of 25.5%, women are underrepresented. Most parliaments remain male-dominated, and women MPs are often underrepresented on decision-making bodies. In the economic field also, women are the most vulnerable groups of the society. Most of the women engage in unpaid activity. There is a need to make women more aware of their rights, be it social, economic, or political. So empowerment of women is the need of the hour through breaking the glass ceiling. When we say glass ceiling is a metaphor referring to an invisible barrier that prevents women from rising to the higher positions in business and politics. The phrase glass ceiling is often used to describe the difficulties faced by women when trying to move to higher roles in a male-dominated hierarchy. The term itself was coined in 1996 in Wall Street Journal. Empowerment as a concept was first brought at the International Women's Conference in 1985 at Nairobi. When we say women empowerment, it means increasing the spiritual, political, social, or economic strength of women. It also involves developing confidence in their capacities. Empowerment is not merely something one does, but an attitude. Until and unless women are empowered, the progress of any nation is not possible. There are three aspects of women empowerment. The first aspect is social empowerment of women. Social empowerment means a change that enables women to increase their capacity to lead a fulfilling human life. The fulfillments of their rights are characterized by external and internal qualities. The external qualities are health, mobility, education, awareness, status in the family, participation in decision-making process, etc. The internal qualities are self-consciousness and self-confidence. Women's social empowerment provides easy and equal access to all the basic services and enables them to realize their full potential. Another aspect is the economic empowerment of women. Economic empowerment is to ensure provision of training, employment, and income-generating activities with both forward and backward linkages, with the ultimate objective of making all potential women economically self-reliant and independent. Economic empowerment has two aspects. One is income or livelihood. The other is whether women have effective control over their income or livelihood. Across the globe, every economy is greatly dependent on the women's unpaid care economy, comprising cooking, cleaning, elder care, child care, and community-based volunteering. Women provide the vast majority unpaid work in terms of number of hours, and they also represent the majority of unpaid carers around the world. Women dedicate on average 3.2 times more time than men to unpaid work, 4 hours and 25 minutes per day against 1 hour and 23 minutes for men. Over the course of a year, this represents a total of 201 working days on an 8-hour basis for women, compared with 63 working days for men. Unpaid work constitutes the main barriers to women's participation in labor markets, while a more equal sharing of unpaid care work between men and women is associated with higher levels of women's labor force participation. Unpaid work is one of the main obstacles to women moving into better quality jobs, affecting the number of hours spent by women in work for pay or profit, their status in employment and working conditions. Over 740 million women around the world work in the informal sector and as low wage workers. There still exists gender wage gaps. The global gender wage gaps between men and women is 23%. Globally, 21 out of 190 countries worldwide restricts a woman's legal capacity and ability to work. Eliminating discriminatory laws and regulations is crucial to overcoming gender-based discrimination and obstacles to economic independence and to creating an enabling environment for women to access decent employment and entrepreneurship opportunities. When women have their own income, they will increase their decision-making power, and it will also have a positive impact in the family as well as in the society. Only when women have their financial independence, they can be economically empowered. The third aspect of women empowerment is political empowerment of women. Political empowerment is obtained through political participation. Political empowerment includes not only the integration into formal political institutions and channels, but extends to any collective action directed towards any type of injustice. With the help of political power, social and economic inequality and injustice can be removed. But this is possible only when women participate actively in politics on par with men. Women's political empowerment is vital for their empowerment in other arenas. While the number of women in parliaments are important, it is also vital for vital to have women in positions of parliamentary leadership. When more women can enter parliament, the easier their access to leadership positions becomes. While the number of women occupying committee chair positions has increased, the committees concerned tend to specialize in the sub portfolios areas such as women's affairs, employment, and education. Since the 1990s, a historically unprecedented number of women have served as presidents and prime ministers across the globe. Srimavo Bandaranaike became the first woman to break the executive glass ceiling in Sri Lanka. Indira Gandhi, Golda Meir, and Margaret Thatcher, among the earliest and best-known women leaders, rose to power before the mid-1980s. When the trend first gained momentum, today, more than 70 women have occupied executive office through breaking the glass ceiling. After the United Nations World Conference held on Women in Beijing in 1995, expectations regarding women's participation in politics have grown in ambition. The last 25 years have seen a significant increase in the proportion of women in parliaments around the world. In 1995, just 11.3% of seats held by parliamentarians were held by women. By 2015, this figure had almost doubled to 22.1%. And although the pace of progress has slowed in the past five years, as of past January 2021, the global share of women in the national parliament is 25.5%, a slight increase from 24.9% the year before. In 1995, no parliament had reached gender parity. However, in 2021, four countries can have at least 50% women in their lower chambers, and one has over 60% of seats held by women, and that country is Rwanda. There are countries in all the regions except Europe that still have lower or single parliamentary chambers with less than 5% women, 3 in the Pacific, 3 in the Middle East and North Africa region, 1 in the Americas, 1 in Asia, and 1 in Sub-Saharan Africa, 9 in total. In 1995, the total was 52 such chambers spanning all regions. So as of 1st January 2021, no women serve in the governments of Azerbaijan, Armenia, Brunei Darussalam, DPR Korea, Papua New Guinea, St. Vincent and Grenadines, Saudi Arabia, Thailand, Tuvalu, Vanuatu, Vietnam and Yemen. Women's participation at the state, national and international politics is highly essential, not only for political empowerment of the women, but also for the greater interest of the nation as a whole. The 73rd and 74th Constitutional Amendment of India, which provides 33% reservation of seats for women in the local elected bodies, is a good example of women's empowerment at the grassroots level. As a result of this, in the recent years, there has been increased participation of women at the lower centers of decision-making structures. So, now I will come to my conclusion. There is a need for strengthening of gender mainstreaming at all levels of government and in policies, programs, plans, and budgets in order to increase support for women's empowerment. Breaking the glass ceiling requires the struggle of those of women herself and of her female counterparts. There is a need to promote women's and men's equal access to political and economic decision-making process. Education acts as a powerful tool to break the silence of a number of sufferings faced by women in their everyday life. And when they go to the light of education, they will develop themselves. It is most commonly heard that women are the mother of a nation, and progress of a nation depends on the development of its women. If a mother is empowered, a family and eventually an entire society are also empowered. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Ms. Nandibala Chanu. A nice presentation. Hello?
Yes, sir. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Can you hear me, sir?
Mr. Mausan, you can call upon the next presenter.
Actually, there are three
presenters. You can invite the next presenter.
Call the second one again. The first and the third is done. Now what is left is the second one. Kaisam Numita, are you present here?
Yeah.
And Professor MC Arun Kumar, are you there? Kaisam Numita and Professor MC Arun Kumar. On the topic impression of body image through internet usage, a case study of Manipuri woman. I think they are not present, sir. Dr. Govinda Raj?
One more.
Sir?
I think they are not here.
Yeah, it seems
yes,
so.
Yes, I think they are not here. You can call up for the next one. Meera Piers.
Yeah, actually, it's all done, sir. Without them, it's done, actually. If they are there, then they can present. So, shall we wind up the session then? Session.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes, okay. Yeah, okay. And before the wind up in the section, I would like to have a few clarification with Nandibala Chanu about on our presentation. Ms. Nandibala Chanu?
Yes, sir. I'm here.
Yeah, your presentation is really done and done wonderfully. And it brought forth the real
Hello, sir.
Presence.
Hello, sir.
Hello, can you hear me? Hello?
I'm Meera. I'm here.
Yeah, okay. This is for Nandibala. I'm sorry. This is for Nandibala.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. The statistical report that you made in your presentation brought forth the real situation of women empowerment of in the present world. In your presentation, you came out with a statement: education is a powerful tool. Do you really concern with the statement?
Yes, sir.
Yes. Do you really concern with the statement, education is a powerful tool for empowerment of women?
Yes, sir.
Yeah?
Yes, sir.
Yeah. I would like to some more clarification on this aspect, please.
Yeah, yeah. Sir, without education, women cannot have skills to be economically empowered. And when women are not economically empowered, they cannot be fully participate in the political decision-making process. So the first important step for empowerment of women is to provide them education so that they can be empowered in the society.
Yeah, actually, I have a slight, I would like to have a slight disagree with the statement that I agree with that, because when the former Prime Minister of India, Vajpayee, acquired his position as the Prime Minister of India, he invited a woman from Tamil Nadu, and he got a blessing from a woman who really did a service for the empowerment of the village that she belongs to. Actually, that particular woman was not educated. Right? This is one of the examples. Obviously, education will be a most powerful tool for the upliftment of either the men or a woman. But it, not alone education, the real empowerment comes from the will power. Hope you agree with me.
Yes, sir.
Yeah, okay. Yeah,
thanks,
good.
Otherwise, for the compliment, sir.
Yes, yes. Otherwise, your presentation is wonderful, really amazing. Best wishes for the future endowment.
Thank you, sir.
Yeah.
Miss Meera, sorry, sir, to interrupt. Miss Meera, is your topic name impression of body image through the internet usage? Is it that one?
Hello?
Yes, ma'am.
Tell me, I'm Meera.
Your topic? Yeah.
I'm presenting a paper today, but you are saying that you didn't see my name in the program.
Yeah, yeah, as per
it's
my schedule.
In the program schedule.
Okay, and which session?
Mr. Maushan?
14.
Yes, yes, sir.
Maushan, yes, I think Meera's name is found. Meera's name is found in the schedule that is given to me.
All right, then. Okay, then she can proceed, sir. So sorry.
Yeah, yeah. Yes.
Ma'am, I apologize for that.
Oh,
you can
okay.
take over. You can
okay,
give a proceed. Thank you.
Okay. I'll share my PPT.
Meera, now you can present.
Sure, ma'am.
Okay, is it visible, sir?
Meera, you can present.
Okay, sir. Thank you, sir. Is it visible? My screen. I am sharing my screen. Is it visible, sir?
Yeah. Yours is visible. Proceed.
Okay. Thank you, sir. My name is Meera, PhD scholar, Avinashlingam Institute of Home Science and Higher Education for Women, Coimbatore, Tamil Nadu. I'm presenting a paper on the topic "Food as a Metaphor for Culture and Identity: A Study of Andhra Nayar's Alphabet Soup for Lovers." Moving to the first slide. Food as a metaphor. Food is commonly used in literature as a metaphor because it is familiar, universal substance that is recognizable and understandable when used as representation. In literature, food may represent many things, such as food in kitchen often signifies domesticity. Food struggle shows famine. An abundance of food symbolizes wealth. Sharing food shows social or community bonds. Eating traditional food marks the native identity of a person. The way in which food connects to cultural and personal identity is unique and personal and particularly significant in India, creating many avenues for study. According to Roland Barthes, a cultural theorist, was one of the first to explore the semiotics of food and culture, raising his ideas in mythologies in which he wrote of food. It is not really a collection of products that can be used for statistical or nutritional studies. It is also, and at the same time, a system of communication, a body of images, a protocol of usages, situations, and behavior. Moving to the next slide. Novel recipes of Andhra Nayar. Andhra Nayar the living writer of this century, is one of the prolific writers in Indian writing in English. Writing about food in her works gives Andanaya the greatest enjoyment, she said once. Descriptions of food items occupy the pages of many of her novels. The mentioning of traditional food items in her novels adds to the readers in hearing the traditional food names in the midst of junk foods. One of her such novels is Alphabet Soup for Lovers. She used food as the literary device in the novel, and she explores the different perceptions of food in the novel. Moving to the next slide, Alphabet Soup, I'll give a gist of the novel. The title itself is striking with its just right amalgamation of an ever new combination of kitchen with a typical love story. The book embellishes with kitchen references. The story tells us how Lena's easygoing life with her husband KK on a tea plantation in Anamalai Hills turns upside down with the arrival of Shulabani, a South Indian superstar. Well, considering the condition of women in India, they are considered to do the household chores, which certainly include preparing food, the all-round cleaning of the premises. If the house is capable of luxuries of life, then the woman in that house might not be working in the kitchen, but certainly there may be a cook to do the duties. So here in the novel, we have a cook named Gomadi. So being a narrator of the novel, a cook can have more to explicate in the novel, but the way of narration is quite different from the typical traditional norms. Moving to the next slide, Gomadi's alphabet journey. The story begins when the illiterate servant of the house, Gomadi, wants to learn English alphabet. Being a typical Tamil woman, she could not decipher the traditional way of learning English alphabet by strictly following A for apple, B for ball, C for cat. Instead, she prefers the letters consequent to each object in her native Tamil language, which could be easy to retrieve in her memory due to familiarity. That leads to an interesting pattern of narrative where each chapter begins with a short description of native food items of Tamil Nadu and a successive story of a family that lives in the Anamalai Hills. Gomadi, one of the leading characters of the novel, highlights the importance of food in the relationship among people in a society. Whatever she thought in the novel is thought in terms of the food she's familiar with. She believes food is the best remedy for many problems that human beings are suffering from. As she makes progress with her lesson, she narrates the events at her employer's home unfolding before her, escorted by her own views and analysis. She comes across as an astute observer. For instance, this is how she defines relationship. For instance, in the novel, she defines the relationship between husband and wife, Lena and KK. These two are like store-bought aplomb, seemingly perfect, but neither flavor nor taste. This is how she defines the relationship of them. And she estimates all people in terms of food items. For example, in a chapter, she identifies Lena in terms of Chepan Kiran. Chepan Kiran means colocasia. She said that Lena is hiding her true self in her stiff exterior like the colocasia. Then moving to the next slide, food nostalgia. Indeed, certain food items will remind us of people who are close to our heart. Dangal chutney, filter coffee, varak, jigadanda were an instance which made Gomadi to talk about her ex-lover Raghavendra Rao. Gomadi believed that food is actually a tool to the heart of another individual, which she usually practiced in her life. These are the food items or dishes that they had experienced together in their younger days. So these food items are associated with her relationship with Raghavendra and the memories of him. Food as a symbol of power hierarchy. The hierarchy of power could be seen even in food we eat. For example, upper class people consume food that signifies exclusively and access to rare goods, while lower class groups on the opposite hand consume readily available foods. In the novel, Gomadi, who belongs to the lower working class people, prefers ration shop rice to godume or atta, which upper class people like Lena's family frequently use. The food selection of a person can determine their social status. For example, a rice diet connotes poverty, whereas godume and basmati rice connote wealth. The author made a definite distinction between what the affluent people and the commoners expected in their diet. It is evident in the lines. As the novel suggested, badam is not everyone's nut. Gomadis consider it as a superior nut, and it is not readily available for the poor, as it is a luxury food in the luxury kitchen. So commoners would prefer other nuts like mundri parp or cashew to badam because it is unaffordable for them. Being superior to others, Shulapani Dev, a well-known film actor who is not so readily available or a rare figure in the world of film, it is just treated just like a badam. He's just treated like a badam. So he is comparing, Gomati is comparing Shulabani to a badam. So next slide, food for reasons. Here, Ledu is used by the author to convey the idea that women need reasons to lead their life happily or to change their life in a way which she expects. She also holds a view that women are afraid to live their life differently from what is expected by the society. Myths and folklores in food. It is worth mentioning that the narration gives a sarcastic tone towards our society's superstitious beliefs about food and menstruation. And also with thoughtful expression, and then I tries to mock the blame the victim, not the culprit attitude of the society. It is evident in the given lines. Karvepillai is not a woman's friend. If we touch it on the days we bleed, it will dry up. It will not dry up if a man who beats his wife, starves his mother, or rapes a two-year-old girl goes near it. That is how Karvepillai is. These lines are scathing attack on the society where the bleeding women were treated as impure and the cruel criminals were depicted as more pure than them. Next is urka, or the pickle. It is an unavoidable part of South Indian kitchen. The paper discloses the beliefs that are attached with pickle among the natives of Tamil Nadu. There are many rules that they must obey about making urka. Sunday, Tuesday, or Wednesday, Friday is not meant for making urka because it is considered as inauspicious to make it on these days. It must be made before the moon disappears entirely behind the clouds on an Amavasya night. When women are menstruating, the urka must not be touched. Similarly, the pickle pot cannot be touched by a woman after being with a man. These are the points which discloses by the writer to highlight how the beliefs perceives women and the subordinate position in terms of even food items. Moving to the next slide, aphrodisiac foods. India has a profuse tradition of aphrodisiac foods, and it might sense that many commonly used ancient Indian aphrodisiacs are things we could find in the kitchen. One of such food is murungakai, or drumstick. Is a frequently used vegetable is having numerous attributes by the traditional Tamilians. This vegetable is facilitating sexual energy of the male, which attracted many unmarried women to the nearest drumstick tree. It's been ages that people believed in this miraculous use of murungakai. Gomati too believed the same, that led her to prepare murungakai sambar when she felt a kind of detachment between Lena and her husband KK. Then next is horse gram, or kola. It is believed that it would give strength to the body. Traditionally, Gomati's family members use kol once in a very week to make her husband strengthier. So as a conclusion, it must be noted that food as a marker of cultural identity tells us who we are, about our memories we share, because food is strongly related to identity. Talking, writing, and representing food necessarily raises important cultural issues. Food is not a mere act of consumption, but it illuminates the behavior of people and society. The paper has been an attempt to show the interplay of language, identity, food, and culture. The paper also discloses the mythical and folkloric concepts regarding the food we ate in a remarkable perspective. It also talks about the harsh reality of each woman's life with food as a metaphor and certain myths behind each food that needs to be debunked from the society and its culture. Being a woman writer, Andanair could easily link a female side that is always looking for different food items that expresses her emotions and feeling to the reading public. Indeed, the food we ate has more significance to play on our life, which explicitly discussed within the narrative. So I'll end my presentation with a quote. Food is not rational. Food is culture, habit, craving, and identity, by Jonathan Safran Foer. Thank you. Thank you so much for patient listening.
Nice. Well, presentation, Ms. Meera.
Thank you, sir.
Mr. Mavshan, is there any other presenter?
Don't know if they have joined or not. I'll just call the name, sir.
Okay.
Last call, ma.
So that Supreme we can. Shiji is one more to be presented. I think she's not available.
Sir, I present.
Okay, please.
Am I audible?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Okay. Myself, Gaudi Ji from Sikkim Micro College. My paper presentation is entitled Answering Chinua's Part. Achebe is one of the Nigerian novelists, poet, professor, and critic, and Things Fall Apart. It was published in 1958. This paper reveals specifically African admirable and commendable system of government, justice, religion, and respect for life, love, and marriage even before colonization. It represents the cultural root of the Igbo in order to provide self-confidence. Igbo culture are the custom, practice, and tradition of the southeastern Nigeria. Achebe aims at conveying to his people and the world that Africans did not hear of culture from Europe and that their societies were not mindless after all, but have a philosophy and culture of great depth, value, beauty, signification, and dignity. First, Achebe admits the democratic government in Igbo culture. Democracy is a system of government in which a power is vested in the people who rule directly or through freely elected representatives. Achebe presents the Igbo society that has a democratic system of government. For instance, before important decisions are taken, the elders or others gathers together at the village square to take decisions that affect the people individuals. This is seen in chapter 1, where the people were informed that a daughter of Umofia was killed in Beino. Collectively, the people agreed that Umofia should follow the law going to war with Umofia, or offering Umofia is a young man and a young virgin as compensation for the death of the daughter of Umofia. Secondly, Achebe admits the justice in Igbo culture. Justice is the under future of democracy. It is observed in the chapter 10 of Things Fall Apart. The village ancestral spirits known as Egbegbu are presented with the case of Usolo, who reports that his in-laws took his wife Mafo's brother, clarifies that his family took Mafo to rescue her from daily beatings by Usolo, her husband. He maintains that his sister will return to her husband. Only if he swears never to beat her again, the Egbegbu consult and their leader, the evil forest, gave a verdict that Usolo to take his in-laws and beg his wife to come back again. He reminds Usolo that fighting a woman is not a braver. Third, religion. Achebe's Igbo has a highly developed system of religion, which is efficiently as the Christian religion. Both Christianity and the Igbo religion approve morality, honesty, straightforwardness, and respect for the God. Both religions and both gods are vengeful only when they are discarded. The difference between the both religions are Igbo society more tolerant than the Christian religion. Igbo are more civilized and superior than the Christian who have come to convert them and bring civilization to them. Igbo culture accepts to worship the gods and spirit of his fathers, even if the gods are not the Igbo gods, but the European religion prefers man to fight for his fellow over religion. Then Igbo society has respect and right to love life. Killing members of one's own life is forbidden, even if advertently done. This is why Obiefu Isedu wants Okongo was not to kill Igmifuna, and even when Okongo kills Isedu's son unknowingly, Okongo was sent on exile. Thus Obereka sees Okongo killing of Igmifuna as a crime against the earth. Then Achebe also celebrates marriage and love in these Things Fall Apart. So marriage has been an age-long celebration. The Achebe's Igbo society consequently admits equality between men and women. As a result, men like Obifu Dulu of Fire Village, who respects their wives, are revered, while men like Usolu, who prefers to beat their wives even in pregnancy, are reprimanded as portrayed in these words. Consequently, Okongo's family is in turmoil. He is in harsh with his wives and children and even kills Igmifuna because he is afraid of being thought weak like his father, and his harshness becomes sacrilegious because he could not even keep the law of the land that forbids him from beating his wife on the eve of the peace week. Achebe portrays his Igbo culture and societies with the flourishes on the pillars of art, music, and party. It is common to decorate walls and bodies at ceremonies. Stories are didactic or moralistic as they teach about the gods and passing on the culture to the younger generation. So Okongo's stories of violence are meant to incite men's true strength. Igbo music is very important and different instruments are used at different occasions. It is a part of Igbo rituals and usually talents are usually handled. These are all also many gods, and to keep them happy, they obey them. Then I conclude, Achube manipulates the English language in his Things Fall Apart to present the Igbo culture as splendid but not without the cultural storms which should be first in order to embrace modernity. So Achebe's Igbo society know that change and progress are useful and indispensable. They recognize that some of their customs are becoming harmful and unproductive, and they are ready to perform action. Change the spiders.
Ma'am, are you done?
Sujit, is it over? Is yours over?
Yes, sir. Yes.
Yeah.
Yes, it's over.
Have you done? Completed?
Yes, sir. It's done, sir.
Yeah, okay. Mason, do you have time or are we running out of time?
Oh, actually, we are running out of time, sir, because since morning it's has been delayed, the program. So it's better if we wrap up.
Do we give time for the participants for the interaction, or shall we proceed with the next one?
Which one? The next session? That session I have to hand to someone else. So we won't conclude the session. Right. You conclude. So
before that, I would like to have two clarifications with the presenters. Shall we?
Sure, sir.
Yeah, Mir, this is for you.
This is.
Yeah, so your presentation is nice for bringing forth the food as a metaphor for culture and identity. Okay. And why, when you talk about culture and identity, why Anita Nair? Why not others?
I find she was a. She discussed more about food in all her works. She gave more importance to food, culture, identity. That's why I select her. And I find it very interesting while reading her books. That's why, sir.
And one more thing. In your presentation, you stated a statement. Eating behavior, food habit is highly associated with one's social status.
Yes, sir.
How do you look at it? Do you agree with the statement?
Yes, sir. Actually, for example, if we are eating luxurious food, means that person is surely he's coming from a well-to-do family, and in the novel itself, it is saying that the upper class families are using the luxurious food, and because of the unavailability of the food, these lower class people can't use those luxurious food. No, because they can't afford those food. That's why. That's the thing, sir. I'm also believing that, sir.
Right, good. Nice presentation and best wishes for the early completion of your doctoral degree.
Oh, thank you, sir. Thank you so much, sir. Thank you for giving me an opportunity. Thank you for the organizers. Thank you so much.
Yeah, best wishes. And now, Suji, only one question to you. Suji is here? I think she left. Okay, Masun, shall we? Shall I
yes, sir. Yeah, it's better. If
yeah, and my special thanks to the organizers and the institutions collaborated with the event, International Virtual Conference on Multidisciplinary Socioeconomic and Cultural Studies, and professors and faculty members and the students involving in the wonderful conference. And my special thanks to Regine Silvert, best friend of mine, for giving an opportunity and remembering me forever. Thank you all. Best wishes to all of you. Thank you, Mason, for accompanying me.
Thank you so much, sir. And we thank you so much, sir, and all the respected presenter. who share their work and then their research. We are very happy with it. So thank you so much, and we wish you all the best in your future work. So take care and stay safe. Thank you.